Victron sure is continuing to up their game. This is the latest revision of the 48-volt multi-plus inverter. This is a 2 kVA unit, which is approximately 1,600 watts, and a 48-volt input. Personally, this is one of my favorite inverters because it has plenty of capability to back up just about any single device you have, and here at Current Connected, we're actually using this to back up our server rack, and they're very robust and reliable units that just work. Today, we're going to be going over the features in this inverter, show you inside, and show you what makes this thing so great. Digging right into the nitty-gritty, this inverter weighs 34 pounds, and it is 19¾ inches tall, 9¼ inches wide, and it is a little bit tapered at the front. At its deepest depth, it is 5¾ inch off the wall. Down here at the bottom of the inverter, you will find some various cord entry glands for all of your different connection cables, as well as the on-off switch. Now, this is a three-position switch. It has on, off in the middle, and then a second position that is charger. So in this mode, it will run just the battery charger without actually acting like a UPS. Two screws come out of the bottom of the inverter, and then this compartment comes off, and this gets to all of our electrical connections. Here in the wiring compartment, you'll find your AC connections. Here we have input line, earth, and neutral, as well as output line, earth, and neutral. This is pretty simple. Essentially, if you cut an extension cord in half, you can wire it right into here, and you'd have your input and power output, and this can act just as a UPS, just like what you'd get to back up your computer. We have some auxiliary connections in here. There is this blue dry contact terminal block. This can simply be lifted up here and removed to make your electrical connections onto, and then once you've made your connections, it just pushes right back onto the pins. This can fit up to 14-gauge wire, although 14-gauge is a little bit of a tight fit. 16-gauge would be more optimal. And this can be programmed for a wide variety of uses, such as turning on additional cooling fans, generator stop-start, and all sorts of other stuff that we'll get into in later videos. From there, we have a remote on-off jumper. Let's say you needed this to turn on and off when a vehicle turned on or off. You can use this port for various different methods of turning this on and off remotely. Then we have the VE bus ports. These can connect to various things such as a Servo GX or the MK3 dongle for programming. Then we have three dip switches here. You can change some settings with those dip switches. While we don't really recommend this, it is possible there. And then last but not least, at the top, we have a temperature sensor input if you were using lead acid batteries and wanted to do temperature correction. One thing I will note, though, is that this does not have the external current sensor input. So if you're doing an ESS system, this is not necessarily the best inverter for you. This inverter is best used for UPS or small systems that aren't doing grid backfeed and that type of thing. Looking back at Victron's previous versions of this inverter, it is very much like the MultiPlus Compact, where there is no secondary AC output. Typically, Victron MultiPlus 2 inverters have a second AC output port where you have that output on when input is available. That second AC output is typically useful when you're running non-critical loads that you only want on when supplemental AC input power is available. Now that said, you still could use one of these auxiliary output relays to turn on a contactor for those type of loads. Then on our other side of the wiring compartment, we have our positive and negative battery terminal connections. These inverters can take a wide range of battery voltage, as low as 38 volts and up to 66 volts. That makes it a great choice if you're using various different battery chemistries, including nickel cobalt based chemistries that have very odd voltage profiles. The torque spec on these DC terminals is 106 inch-pounds or 8.8 foot-pounds. You'll want to make sure you use a torque wrench when you're dialing this stuff in because that torque is pretty critical. As far as getting your cabling in and out of the inverter, they have these dustproof glands I mentioned, and they made a nice notch in here, so if we remove the terminals for the battery, you can easily get your battery cable in here and get it in without trying to fish it through a really tiny hole. Now, for this inverter, we're not pulling that much current. It's about 40 amps at most. So I typically recommend the smallest gauge battery cable we have, and that'll be a 6-gauge. These are M8 studs, so you'll want to use 5/16 ring terminals. Now it's time for everybody's favorite part of the video, the teardown. There are two screws here on the bottom side where the wiring compartment is that hold this blue lid on, and then four screws on each side. And with those removed, the top lid just pops right off. And then one thing that is very different about this inverter is there is no ribbon cable to the front panel. It's all integrated into the board. Now, getting inside this inverter is very simple. We have the DC input here that goes into an H-bridge circuit. This is what essentially is actually chopping up the power and inverting it before it is ran into the toroidal transformer up here. Now, one thing I don't like on this inverter is there are some chokes just glued to the transformer. Normally, Victron puts these on a board on the side of the transformer. However, they've chosen not to do that in this version. That is unfortunate, but this is a much lower priced inverter compared to some of their nicer ones, so you lose a little bit of build quality as a result. After the transformer, the power comes here into the switching circuit. This looks very typical of a Victron inverter. There are some nice big old contactors in there, and this is a 50 amp transfer switch you're looking at here, that white box right there that says 24 volts DC, and then the main processor boards here going vertical. And then this is a different thing that I haven't seen on any other inverter. Hear how the LEDs have this plastic tube that the light shines up through to the front panel. Typically, this is a daughter board attached directly to the backside of the front panel. Typical for Victron, there is a 120 millimeter cooling fan that pulls air across the FET board and then blows it across the toroidal transformer and out the top. And there are some good close-up shots on the circuit boards for you. Something that really sets Victron apart from the competitors is their incredibly low idle consumption, especially considering they have that big transformer. So I'm getting set up here. I have my Fluke 287 meter. This is a NIST calibrated multimeter. I'm running through it to measure the current going into the inverter at idle. And then I'm also going to be measuring the voltage at the terminals, so that way we can get a true idle calculation for what this inverter consumes. So with my meters hooked up now, we're sitting at 54.7 volts at the terminals, and right now we're drawing 2.5 milliamps. If I turn the inverter on, you can see after it kicks in, we go up to 2.2 tenths of an amp. If we calculate that out, we get 12 watts of idle draw, and this is only rated at 11 watts of idle draw. So we're 1 watt over the spec, but hey, I gotta give it to Victron. 12 watts is barely anything. It's not like some other inverters of this similar size that draw approximately 2 to 3 amps that require far bigger battery banks just to sit there doing nothing. Now, not only are these inverters very efficient in terms of their idle consumption, they're also very quiet. So I have this Fluke 945 sound meter, and I'm going to have to actually be quiet for this part. But if I rest it here at the input of the inverter, we can get a reading for how loud this is. And honestly, it's barely even noticeable. Let's compare that to turning the inverter off. With the inverter off, we're at the bottom of the meter. It is undetectable. Now let's do this test again with a little bit of load on the unit. We're wired in now with an AC input, and I still have the meter right in the wiring compartment, right in line with the fan. I'm gonna turn the inverter on. It's gonna go into charger mode and start charging the battery. So at this point, we're running around 70 decibels with the fan running. And you can see when I start talking, it really starts to spike up. So this is not much louder than a normal conversation. With that last test, we figured out what this sounded like to our ears. You're probably wondering how noisy is the AC output. So I have some 12 gauge wire on this inverter here, solid wire. It's just kind of on there haphazardly, but that is so that I can hook onto it with my scope probes. I have the oscilloscope here in the background, and if I turn the inverter on, we're gonna see it ramp up here. And I'm gonna need to adjust this here on the scope a little bit. But we can see it's a pretty darn good sine wave. Let me get you a close-up on that. So you can see there's a little bit of distortion right there at our zero crossing point. But other than that, it is pretty clean. There is a little bit of digital noise here. That's going to be our switching frequency of the H bridge inside of the inverter. That's what causes that little bit of fuzz. But overall, this is a really good sine wave, and we'd expect nothing less with it having that big old transformer inside. That clean sine wave does not go away as soon as we put load on it. I have a outlet haphazardly wired on the inverter right here with a 250-watt halogen light. And you can see the light's not flickering. Everything is good over here. And it's not making a total mess of that sine wave. So yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed this video and built up some of your interest in this MultiPlus inverter. If you're looking to purchase one of these, be sure to get it through us. We'll put a link to our store down in the description below. Other than that, we hope you enjoyed, and we'll see you in the next video. Thanks.